This video is intended for training purposes. Healthcare facilities should develop procedures based on available equipment and staff. It is imperative that all protocols be tested and practiced while wearing personal protective equipment to ensure applicability and team readiness. Containment wrap. Use of a containment wrap when transferring a patient with Ebola or other special pathogen. In this video, we identify the special considerations needed for transferring a patient infected with Ebola or other special pathogen in a containment wrap at your facility. When transferring or receiving a patient infected with Ebola or other special pathogen in a containment wrap, healthcare workers must work carefully to ensure that they and the patient remain safe throughout the procedure. A containment wrap is a fluid impermeable enclosure that surrounds a patient in order to contain a pathogen, preventing the pathogen from spreading outside of the containment wrap. Patient transport using a containment wrap is a systematic and orderly process that should be practiced using the equipment available at your facility. Throughout the procedure, healthcare workers will be wearing PPE that may be uncomfortable and restrictive. This may result in decreased dexterity and tactile sensation. For this reason, healthcare workers are urged to work cautiously and be mindful of their limitations. Prior training with a containment wrap while wearing PPE is essential. This will allow healthcare workers to experience firsthand the challenges they will encounter during a live procedure. Communication with team members is an example of one such challenge. During a procedure, PPE can be noisy and muffle sounds, making communication difficult. Healthcare workers will need to speak in a loud, clear tone and be prepared to ask co-workers to repeat themselves to verify understanding. Consideration will need to be given to the size and clinical condition of the patient, as these factors could influence the number of staff members required for the procedure, their skill level, and the equipment requirements for safe patient transport. The presence of symptoms like fever, vomiting, or diarrhea may require the staff to determine if a containment wrap is the most appropriate method for patient transport. If the containment wrap is the preferred method for patient transport, considerations for patient safety may include administering antipyretics or strategically placing cold packs to reduce the patient's temperature. Necessary equipment for the containment wrap procedure includes a wheeled stretcher or gurney, a slide board or backboard, a fitted bed sheet, two flat bed sheets, an extra-large impervious surgical sheet or drape. Consider the need for an extra surgical sheet if the patient's size makes it difficult to close the containment wrap. Ensure the surgical drape does not contain a window opening, such as those sheets that provide access for surgical sites or anesthesia. A biohazard bag. If your facility uses an autoclave to process waste, you may want to use an autoclave bag. An emesis bag. An emesis bag is preferred to a basin as it contains the emesis, prevents splash, and is less likely to spill. Two procedure masks, one mask for the patient, and an extra mask in case the patient's mask needs to be replaced. A spill kit that meets the needs of the institution's protocol. It may be useful to have these items on hand in a pre-assembled containment wrap kit to be ready when needed. As with any procedure in a special pathogen isolation area, be careful to avoid using any unnecessary materials as they take up valuable space and generate extra waste. While performing the patient transport procedure, the care team should have easy access to any additional items that may be needed along the transport route, such as an extra spill kit or additional personal protective equipment. Prior to performing the containment wrap procedure, review institutional protocol with all care team members and discuss the plan of action. The protocol should determine the number of care team members required for the procedure. At minimum, three care team members are recommended, two to perform the containment wrap procedure, and a third to monitor the patient. However, patient size, acuity, and clinical condition should be taken into consideration when determining final staffing requirements. Confirm each member of the care team knows and understands their role and responsibility by providing just-in-time training prior to the procedure. Educate care team members on the equipment and supplies used during the procedure. As an example, it will be important that staff identify which side of the surgical sheet or drape is fluid impervious and which side is not. Prior to transport, The patient should be assessed to determine if any pre-medication for vomiting, diarrhea, or anxiety is necessary. When transporting the patient, ensure the patient is traveling feet first to decrease the potential for nausea and vertigo. The head of the stretcher can be raised to help make the patient more comfortable. During the containment wrap and transport process, the patient may experience anxiety or fear. Care team members will need to be mindful of this and seek to provide comfort and support to the patient while maintaining their dignity. As with any procedure, ensure institutional protocols are followed at all times. For example, conduct a time out with all care team members just prior to the procedure to validate the approach and process and ensure all required equipment and supplies are prepared. When preparing the stretcher for the patient transport procedure, remember to work as a team while following institutional protocol. The containment wrap procedure begins with the preparation of the stretcher. Dress the transport stretcher with a fitted bed sheet. If a flat sheet is being used, do not tie the corners of the sheet, as this will make it difficult to remove. Place a draw sheet over the bottom fitted sheet. Position the draw sheet on the stretcher across the area where the patient's mid-body will rest. The draw sheet will be used to assist the patient's transfer from stretcher to bed. Open the extra-large surgical drape and place it on the stretcher. Ensure the fluid impervious side of the surgical drape is facing down, with the sides of the surgical drape evenly distributed along the sides and foot of the stretcher. Place the waist bag, emesis bag, and procedure masks under a corner of the mattress for easy access when needed. Consistently placing the items in this location will ensure care team members can access them quickly at all times. Do not place items on the frame beneath the stretcher, as these items may roll off during the transport procedure. To prepare the stretcher to receive the patient, position the stretcher alongside the patient bed and engage the brakes on both units. Fold a flat sheet lengthways to use as a draw sheet. Place the folded flat sheet with an absorbent pad on top, beneath the patient's mid-body. Roll the patient away from the stretcher. Place a slide board under the folded flat sheet and absorbent pad to create a bridge from the patient bed to the stretcher. Next, pull the patient across the slide board from the patient bed onto the stretcher. Remove the slide board from beneath the patient and place it on the patient bed for cleaning and decontamination. Perform hand hygiene, evaluate PPE for potential contamination, and consider the need to change your disposable apron. At the foot of the stretcher, lift the bottom of the surgical drape up and fold it over the patient's feet. Fold the sides of the surgical drape up and over the patient. Leave the patient's head uncovered. The containment wrap can be wrapped loosely around the patient. It is not necessary to wrap the patient so tightly that movement is restricted. Ensure the emesis bag is readily accessible. If appropriate, the patient may choose to hold the emesis bag during the transport procedure. Place a procedure mask on the patient. Perform hand hygiene and change gloves if necessary, following institutional protocol. Drape the second flat sheet over the patient. Raise the side rails of the stretcher for patient safety. When the patient and care team are ready, begin patient transport to the isolation unit following institutional protocol. A patient in a containment wrap that has been transferred to your unit will need to be carefully removed from the wrap to avoid any unnecessary contamination of the area or the personal protective equipment of the healthcare workers. To prepare to receive the patient, position the stretcher next to the patient bed and engage the brakes on both units. Roll the patient away from the bed. Place a slide board underneath the bottom draw sheet to create a bridge from the stretcher to the patient bed. Pull the patient across the slide board from the stretcher onto the bed. Once the patient is safely on the bed, remove the slide board to the stretcher, disengage the brakes on the stretcher, and move it away from the work area. Begin extracting the patient from the containment wrap by removing and discarding the top sheet. Removal of this top sheet should be done slowly with as little disturbance as possible to avoid aerosolizing potential pathogens. Open the surgical drape from the sides first and then the feet. Be mindful to touch only the outside portion of the surgical drape using slow, deliberate movements to avoid aerosolization. Once open, roll the sides of the surgical drape toward the patient. Once the drape has been gathered, roll the patient to one side and continue rolling the drape. Be careful to contain any bodily fluids that may be enclosed within the surgical drape. The inside of the surgical drape must be considered contaminated. As you are working, be mindful not to lose sight of your hands. Remember that you are working in an area where there may be hazards, such as contaminated bodily fluids or inadvertently placed sharps. Once the containment wrap is free from beneath the patient, dispose of it using institutional waste protocol and perform hand hygiene. Additionally, consider the need to change your disposable apron. Assess the patient for safety and continue with the plan of care. After the procedure is complete, all reusable equipment, including the stretcher, should be placed in a location where they will not contaminate other equipment or surfaces, or be a hazard while waiting for cleaning and decontamination. Clean and disinfect the area, including areas in which the stretcher traveled, following institutional protocol. Additional resources are available at the NETEC and CDC websites. If you have any questions, please contact NETEC directly at info@netec.org. Thank you.